Good evening.
Good evening, Ronnie. Thank you so much for taking out the time and being here. We love having you and we love listening to you talk. And I'm sure our audience is going to love that as well. And I believe we're talking about a topic which is very dear to you, which is building for the long term and not for valuation. So, you know, to kick things off, if you, you know, could tell us a bit about the fact that people do call you serial entrepreneur, right? It's a known fact. Do you really believe in that status? And what would you say is the key to your success?
Yeah, well, firstly, good evening. And just phenomenal to see such young faces here. And, a great gender mix. I don't think it's by accident. I think that's what the future of India is. So I think we're all very proud. I'm here because I'm curious. I want to know what everyone else is thinking. What's the new generation thinking? And the team I work with very closely, frankly, are all under 30. And I think that works better because there's so much dynamism in the room. And basically, at the end of the day today, the good part for all of you all is whatever you're creating, product, service, anything that you're having, you're that target group. Maybe not that full target group, because I think some of you all come from a different ecosystem, some come from a different ecosystem, some of you all may be a little bit more privileged. We need to understand the other side of the consumer, but overall, you are that target group. So I think that's, to go to your question specifically, you know, actually, it's quite contrarian that for someone who's actually stuck it out and built for the long term, and I would say stayed the course, to be called a serial entrepreneur just sounds like every 4 to 5 years you're kind of changing your course, which actually hasn't been the case with me, which is why I don't. Besides which, of course, as I keep saying, serial normally means premeditated, you know, like a serial killer. It's like, it's a premeditated move. And frankly, there is no premeditated move, because if you are conceptually thinking that every 4 to 5 years or 6 years, I'm going to shift gears, you're going to fail multiple times because you can't time failure and you can't time success. So I think anyone thinking I'm going to do this for 5 years and I'm going to have an exit, very confused a lot of people. You have to build for your own vision. So I think, no, I don't think serial entrepreneur as a concept works, because premeditatingly thinking about somebody else's vision. Because if you want to exit and if you want to not be and move on, the first thing in the question is, who are you building and for whose vision? Because if you're contemplating what somebody 5 years later would think of your company, that they would like to buy it out or invest, it actually means it's not your vision. And then it's downhill from there.
Absolutely. I think that's very well put. Coming to UpGrad, right? When you started UpGrad, I feel like the entire startup world and more so EdTech was, you know, only talking about valuations at the time.
Everyone talks about valuations. I'm glad by the 3-4 conversations I had here, nobody talked about valuations. Everyone was talking about a product. Everyone was talking about a great thing. So I think maybe it's the new generation, hopefully, and not corrupted by what media keeps talking about valuations and not that single horn thing that we all call, what is it called?
Unicorn
or something like that. Yeah.
Right. So, I mean, how did you at the time ensure that you don't get caught up in the number game? And I mean, you've done that for many years now, and that's why probably UpGrad is where it is today. So
look, I think it's very, very important. If anyone building a business thinks the best trump card or the thumping card is that you raised money, that's the first responsibility. It's not an asset. It's actually a liability. Because at the end of the day, if you want to stay for the next 40 years, you'll soon realize that actually raising money is a liability, not an asset. It's a great cash flow and it is a positive. But at the end of the day, you have to give a return. So taking that step is one of the most important things. Second, I think the sector, which is learning, skilling, workforce development, education, whichever way I looked at that, I've seen it from the outside and you don't need that kind of money. So I think the other tragic part was, here was a sector getting overfunded. Third, I just want to tell you, the biggest killer for innovation is raising too much money. Because what does that mean? You actually raise it. Some investors told you something about the four seasons and stock it up for the winter because nobody else is going to do that. Complete crap. Complete disillusionment. It's their agenda of how they want to run it. you need the money when you need the money. And I think, firstly, when you look at raising funds, if you look at it when you're tamping up, the first thing you want to do is spend. And most of it then goes into what I would call low priority, low pressure for innovation thinking. Because you think of marketing, you think of experimenting, you think of hiring a few more people than you need. You also think, I'll try this and I'll try that. Somebody, suddenly you become a diversification king versus actually being a focus king. So you've got to really watch out for the fact that funding is required, but this chest thumping moment is a problem. And I think that's really where most sectors go sideways before they actually come online. From our point of view, I think in UpGrad, only because I was a serial entrepreneur, though I don't think, and I'd exited media, I kind of knew it because I come from a lower middle class family. I started with 37,000 rupees and a very clear message from my dad around much younger than some of you all when I was starting up. After they finally accepted that I wanted to be an entrepreneur and not go out and do my chartered accountancy and MBA was, if you want to go out and start something, do it. But if something goes wrong, we're with you morally, but financially we can't bail you out. When you go with that no opening balance, it's a very different approach to life, right? It just keeps your feet grounded for the rest of your life. And I think that's a great virtue for whatever you all are doing here, because the more your feet are on the ground, the higher chance of success. So I think in that, I knew exactly how important it is and the value for what you want to build for. So I think when we started off, the best test for UpGrad was for the first 5 years, we didn't raise any money from external, but we didn't bootstrap, thankfully, because I'd finished one innings and I had a liquidity. And so therefore one is putting one's own capital, which is the best way to go about it. But the beauty of that is it allowed us to go completely with our own vision. Because the minute you have investors, you're foxtrotting. You're doing a little bit of a dance because of the simple reason you're doing it, but you need to be respectful about what they've come in for. Suddenly your priorities change. For a lot of you, vision gets diluted a little bit or a lot, depending on how many investors you get. I think some of the biggest failure stories today is not only when you raise too much money, which is definitely a higher chance of failure than not, but when you raise it from too many people, because then you've got to diverse. It takes a very mature founder at 30, at 40, at 50, and at 60 to manage multiple investors. And that would be, I think, that's something you really need to figure out, that choosing people that have a slightly more longer term vision is very, very, very important.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, since you mentioned UTV, tell us about that UTV sale to Walt Disney, a business that I think you and Zarina built over so many decades. Was it emotionally difficult also because you were so, so attached to it?
No, I don't think we were attached to it. I think, and I realized that after we exited, that there's a small difference, but a huge difference, but actually a small difference between being emotional about your business and being passionate about your business. And I think we were much more passionate, but not as emotional. Emotional means you can't let it go. Passion means you'll do whatever you want to do it. But emotional means you won't collapse if it goes away from you. I think your emotional attachment to your family or even to a pet is a very different one than the passion that you would need to do with your business. So I think that is something that comes over a certain period of time. But I think the journey was very, very simple. It wasn't pre-planned, firstly, right? It absolutely wasn't pre-planned. Here we had was a great brand, which is the Walt Disney Company, a 100 times bigger brand than UTV that we had created. And they were investors with us. And one fine day, they just popped the question. I think the other part here is, if you go looking for someone to sell your company to, you're going to get 1/4 the value. But if somebody finds you, you're going to get 10x the value. And that's just the law of gravity. Because when somebody knocks on your door, then you need a conversation where they're coming into your arena, so to speak. And if you knock on somebody else's door, you could be waiting at the reception for 45 minutes before they let you in. And that's the difference between wealth creation and ultra wealth creation, or value creation and ultra value creation. So I think they were on our board, and I think one thing led to another, and they popped the question, and it just sounded the right thing to do. So I don't think it took more than 30 days of a decision of being less emotional but practical. Because I think, not because we were at a crossroad, but For multiple reasons, we just felt this was the absolute right thing for us to do, for the brand that we had created, for the company, for the 1,300 people at that time that were working with us. And even today, zero regrets.
Absolutely. And, you know, there are a lot of young founders here today. When you have investor money or that eagerness to succeed suddenly, you know, what are some of the main challenges of staying focused on long-term growth and, you know, sort of not getting caught into the pressure of showing results immediately? You could probably give us some anecdotes of when you struggled with something like that.
I think it would be extremely silly for us to assume that we can let go of the day-to-day struggle. It is there to be there. You're not going to get there. The point is, whatever you plan, Murphy's Law will apply. Whatever you plan, things will start going wrong. Whenever you think I need that one extra hour for me to strategize and think of the long term, you won't be able to do that. Whenever you think, how can I think of the long term because I don't know whether I'm going to survive tomorrow. But that's the beauty, right? That's why you're an entrepreneur. That's why you're an entrepreneur. Because in spite of all that, if you're building that foundation, that's when you're going to build something really, really magical, really, really long term. You're not building for the next. The real success comes when you outlast people. The real value comes when you outlast people. The real value comes from many of those aspects. So I would just say very simply, that's the core. I mean, that you have to stick around to sort of outlast.
Right. And what role does profitability play in this case? And how does one assess the health of, you know, the business beyond valuation?
Yeah, I don't know. Valuation is a figment of five people's imagination in some form or the other, whether we like it or not, right? I mean, let's be very clear. Till you get market conditions defining your value, and that's the shock that people have. I think the problem 3 years back is India had 125 unicorns, and slowly that slowed down. Thank God for that, right? And I was very clear that out of those 125 unicorns, not more than 25 will be unicorns 3 years later. And I think we're 1.5 years into that journey. And I think the statistics will hold out. Because when you set yourself up for that, and then when you go into the real world or a public market or where you're really going to get into the market, you have to keep justifying that. Because before that, you did a lot of presentations and posturing. Five people who had money to disperse valued you. It was whether there was a FOMO or whether there was not. So there's no real, what you're building is a serious business. And I think if you build a serious business, you will get value. There's no question about that. Okay. So I think there's no question of profitability or not profitability. That's not a question mark. It can have a sense of timing. Let's be very clear. The modern day service industry, you expense everything. Before that, when people were building factories and only into manufacturing, you would put up 1,000 crore of a capital. But it wasn't a loss of 1,000 crores because then you depreciated that. And only 250 crores may have hit your P&L, or even 100 crores may hit your P&L, and then the next 10 years. There's no concept of that kind of amortization today. So, yes, service companies and new age companies will have higher losses in the beginning. There's nothing wrong with that. But as long as you know that in that context, you're not running a not-for-profit, and that you're not running a business based on valuation or based on five people who will judge you for your valuation because you're at a high growth level, because they're the best and worst fair weather friends. And nothing wrong with them because that's their business. Their business is to be fair weather friends because they're with you for a transient period of 4 to 5 and 6 years. The conversation and value add they will have is not to say, how do you see yourself 20 years from now? They're going to see how you're going to see yourself and, you know, have 8 quarters and 9 quarters and 10 quarters. That's where at this age, if you can build those fundamentals, don't get stressed about valuation. And nothing completely falls off. The amount of times I've had minus zero bank balances, which anyone would have called a failure, have been multiple times. But that's not the end. It's not the beginning, but it's not the end.
Wow, I think that was a great note to end our conversation on, Ronnie, given that we're on a very strict time schedule. So I'm going to open the floor for questions from the audience. Anyone who's willing to, okay, we have someone right here. If we can pass the mic, please. Thank you.
As I said, firstly, you are a huge inspiration for all the entrepreneurs out here. So thank you for all that you do. My question is, as a leader, you have certain belief systems. Over the decades, over the years, is there a belief system that has changed for you and why?
I think the speakers have changed. Because of that said, can you repeat the question?
So I was asking that, you know, as a leader, you have many belief systems, your foundation, your core principles. Over the decades, as the world is evolving, as a leader, do you think any belief system that has changed for you?
You know, when you look at this, especially the giving back element, the foundation we started, I started when I was 23. Just FYI, we renamed it the Swadesh Foundation after one of our movies much, much later, only in the last 10 years. Because for the first time, I had a bank balance that wasn't indebtedness, where I hadn't taken a loan for my daughter to go abroad and study, etc. So I think it started at about 23. I have no idea how and when. It was just one of those impulsive situations. But I think today, when I see a lot of the younger generation, including my daughter, who did her her film degree from USC, came back, wanted to be in films, and then after one film decided that's not her forte and started a not-for-profit, which is a mentor-mentee program. So I think today in all of us, and I've spoke to some of you all, there is a context where you're thinking of impact. Because today, if you really want to be and create valuable companies in India, you have to have the word impact in your thing. Because if you're creating that impact, you'll open the market. It's a very price-sensitive market. If you're suddenly looking at something which is only for the top 1% of the population, of 0.5% of the population, it's fine. But that's not what India is. And you're going to find it difficult because after a certain stage, you'll reach a glass ceiling sooner than if you're in a much more price sensitive. So I think that balance of that not-for-profit versus profit from that very early stage, outside of that one line from my dad that says, I cannot bail you out financially, just keeps grounding you down. So anytime a gas balloon lights you with an investor saying, this is great, and can I put $100 million? You keep deflating that and coming back to ground earth.
Great. I think that was, I hope that answered your question. Anyone else? Any questions? I thought there'd be a lot more. Okay. There are two of them. Maybe we'll take...
Okay. Yeah, and if you can just talk a little louder because the speakers are that way, so I can't hear. Plus, I've got tinnitus, so I have a little bit of a problem anyway hearing.
So you have built multiple ventures from ground up. So how do you, what's your suggestion in dealing with the people who are there in the beginning but reach the limitation? What's the contribution of your venture, the growth of the company after some time? Initial core team, once they reach their limitation, how do you suggest dealing with those core team?
What do we suggest for? Sorry. Can you just hold the mic a little closer?
Okay. Can you hear me? Yeah. So I was asking you, how do you deal with the initial founding team when they reach their limitations towards the contribution to a growth of this venture that you're building?
When you...
when the initial co... Okay.
Do you... Yeah. I'm having
to... Exactly.
Thank you. Yeah. No, I think it's a very relevant and a good question. I think the concept of this whole 0 to 1, 1 to 10, I found it quite mythical because firstly, now today, there's no 0 to 1 and 1 to 10. It's 0 to 0.5, 0.5 to 1, 1 to 1.15, 1.5 to 2. It's going to be as laborious as that because the changes are there. So don't look for some magic suddenly when 1 becomes 1 is to 10. Yes, people do have a context that they can max out. And I think actually they're the treasure troves because they've got a lot of reference and context of what you want to do. I think having those frank conversations with them about their career moves where actually they can be placed in many other trustworthy positions or positions where you need a stable growth but not a high growth will put less pressure on them. And actually you'll be amazed. The more frank your conversation with people you're most afraid to have a frank conversation with, they half the time or 90% of the time, they wanted to have that conversation in the first place but did not approach it. So every time I've had a conversation where somebody says, my tech guy is having a problem, etc., and he's there and he wants to work from home and I've got this friction, I'm saying, talk it out. So I would say for people there, we shouldn't lose them. They realize their potential that they've sort of maxed out there. If they've got ambitions of going out and starting something of their own, then it's a loss for you. So you should figure out why you haven't been able to accommodate them. But I think there's room for those people because of the simple reason that they need to be nurtured and they'll be your faithfuls at every given stage. I found that.
Thank you, sir.
Great. I think we'll wrap it up with this. I'm so sorry we're running very late and out of time also. But thank you so much, Ronnie, for your time.
Thank you.
I think this was a very, very insightful conversation.
Great. And congratulations to all of you all here for winning it. I'd rather say best of luck. I'm very reticent to say congratulations most of the time because that means already it's a finished game. This is just the start. This is just one more firecracker, one more impetus, one more inspiration, one more thumbs up that says go for it. The only thing I would say for you all is it's a privilege. So take that privilege on and look left, look right at many other people who don't have that privilege and how you can rope them in.
Thank you so much, Ronnie. I think that was beautiful.